thanks for being here. My name is Kip Fagan. I'm the director of the Profane. And I want to quickly introduce you to the two guys to my left. This is my friend and our amazing playwright, Zayd Dohrn, who wrote the Profane. And to Zayd's left is our special guest. We're really thrilled to have him, the incredibly talented writer, actor, creator, Aasif Mandvi. There are, you know, extended bios in your programs if you want to learn more about those two or even me. The Profane is about two American immigrant families, both originally from Muslim-majority countries. The Almedin family lives in the heart of the West Village and is vehemently atheistic, intellectual, cosmopolitan. And the Osman family lives in White Plains, recently moved from Queens, and are observant Muslims, more traditional and conservative and devout. The events of the play take place after the son from the devout family and a daughter from the atheistic family are engaged to be married, and hijinks ensue. I wanted to kick off, we're going to hear about three scenes from the play, but before we started, I just wanted to kick off by asking what is typically the million-dollar question in events like this, which is, Zayd, why'd you write the play? What inspired the play? What brought you to these people and these themes?
Okay. Well, thank you all for coming. I think I started writing this play about 2 years ago, so it was before, obviously, we were contemplating things like the Muslim ban, which the play is now kind of being performed in a different context. But I was thinking at the time about other bans and other conflicts that were happening around around the religion, around culture, around immigration. I was particularly thinking of things like the ban in France on the hijab and the burqa. I was thinking about the Danish cartoonist controversy, which I'm sure many of you remember. And I was thinking about the conflict between kind of what we see as liberal cosmopolitan tolerance, the value of tolerance and free speech, and what seemed to be a strange contradiction in that value, that in some cases, you know, you would be banning certain expressions of religion, or say the 9/11 mosque right here in New York, the ban on certain kinds of religious expression. And then at the same time, when things like the Danish cartoonists or the Charlie Hebdo magazine, the defense was free speech, radical free speech. And so I started to get interested in this kind of the conflict between the values of liberalism, in particular free expression, and the way that those values sometimes seem to contradict themselves. So anyway, those ideas were in my mind. And then once I started to have my antenna up about them, I started to notice those conflicts in people I knew, in families I knew, Muslim families, but also Jewish families and Christian families, and I started to think, like, there's something here, a story that I could maybe tell about the way those conflicts manifest themselves in the present day.
Cool. And Aasif, I just wanted to ask you if you could give us a little information about your background, your upbringing. You're from originally from India.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're an immigrant first to the UK, right? And then
yeah.
to the USA. So you have lots of hyphens you can claim if you want to, right?
Yeah.
And I just wondered, like, how what Zayd's talking about the influences of the play resonates with you, having been, you know, being a multi-hyphenate.
Well, what I thought was really interesting about the play when I read it was that you chose to take on this issue of liberalism versus sort of more conservatism within the Muslim community. Like, you could have very easily made the liberal intellectual sort of family, you know, a white American family, but to take it on within the context of two Muslim families, I think is interesting and braver, I think, you know. So and actually raises more questions, you know. It's not quite as obvious. So, and I come from a family that has, you know, there are people in my family who are very religious and very conservative, you know, and then there are other people who are atheists and much more you know, academic intellectuals sort of that way. And so I have that within my own family, and I came from a very sort of, you know, I often joke about how I'm the worst Muslim ever, you know, like I have been in more bars than mosques in my life. And so,
Were you grappling with that growing up? Like, in your nuclear family, did you have people who were devout and also?
Yeah, like I have uncles who are atheists and don't believe in, you know, and then I have on the other side people who are incredibly religious. My mother was very religious, and her brothers were not, you know. So within the same family, we have divergent sort of beliefs and, you know, so I thought that was a really interesting thing about this play, about taking on that.
It's interesting because like a lot of the way I work, not just with this play, with other plays as well, is like trying to find ways to make, you know, big issues, intimate, small family
right.
issues. And so that's interesting about the making it within the community. I just always thought of it as a play about these people who kind of knew each other and loved each other. And even within generations of the same family, the weird split between these different values.
Well, it's interesting because when I read it, you know, I didn't meet you. I thought you were a brown guy. So I was like, clearly, I mean, a Muslim guy who wrote this.
He tricks everyone with his first name.
I know, and I was like, Zayd, I've never heard that name. But it is interesting because it's also the immigrant experience story happens in that, you know, when you, and how the religion ties into the immigrant story and what, and the assimilation versus, there's one kind of assimilation that happens which is sort of the rejection of, and then there's the other kind of assimilation, which is a re-examination of one's beliefs and,
yeah.
you know, of one's religion, as it were. And so that is an interesting story. Just and I read that just as an immigrant. I thought, oh, this is an interesting idea as an immigrant story.
Yeah, the two families in the play are both very assimilated, very American, but in... you know, I was talking to the actors one of the first days about how maddening it is to try to decide what it means to be American, because there's really no answer to that, and they've become American in two like wildly divergent ways.
Right. Well, we will know once America is great.
That's right. Then there'll be one way.
Then there'll only be one type of American. That's the great one.
On that note, I want to set up the first scene so that we don't go down that road too much, or we'll all drive each other crazy. In this scene, Amina and Sam, who are the young engaged couple, are back home from college over a Thanksgiving break. They're in the West Village, and... I'm sorry. That's not true, is it?
Doesn't
oh, yeah, it
right.
is. It is. they've come home to announce their engagement to the Almedin family. Amina has sort of craftily manufactured some get-to-know-you time between her father and her fiancé by way of helping out with the Thanksgiving dinner preparations. That happens right before this scene, and then this is a scene between Amina and Raif, her father. And I'm going to introduce a couple of the actors, Ali Faranakian playing Raif and Tala Ash playing Amina.
Hey, how'd it go?
I have never peeled so many vegetables in my life. Look at my hands, like a charwoman.
I meant how'd it go with Sam, Papa. You guys talk?
Sure.
And?
He's very polite.
Polite?
Yes, what do you want me to say, Amina? I have nothing against the
boy. I should have never told you about his family. I should have just let you
You think I wouldn't have been able to tell?
Tell what? What is there to tell?
He's practically got a blinking red sign on his forehead.
Oh, and you're passing with the blue jeans and the Mets hat?
This is who I am. It's not a pose, Amina. There's a big difference, you know, between pretending to be a thing and actually being that thing.
You totally play the immigrant card when it suits you. Half the time, you're this all-American dad born and bred, the other half a dissident novelist living in exile. Which is it?
I can't be both. I'm an internationalist. You know that. I have no country.
You came here on a student visa. Nobody threw you out. You could go back at any time.
Exile doesn't necessarily mean you can't go back.
No? Exile, the state of being barred from one's native country, typically for political or punitive reasons.
Ah, you've done your research.
Always pays to be prepared for an argument with
mm-hmm.
you.
Mm-hmm. And you don't think the definition applies?
You weren't barred from going back, Pa. You left. You chose.
It doesn't say expelled. You can be barred from your homeland by political realities on the ground. Religious fundamentalism, a hostility
your
to free thought and expression.
Your homeland is Greenwich Village.
Yes, which is, thank God, practically its own nation
and
state.
And Sam's family, no matter what you think, they're just as American as we
they
are.
They hold themselves apart in their little enclave. They keep to their tribe.
Whereas we mix?
I mix. I go all over. I give readings, I attend conferences.
And those people aren't your tribe?
Those people are artists and academics and intellectuals from all over the world.
And are any of them poor, uneducated? Do any of them not read The New Yorker, Pa? That's your tribe.
That's ridiculous. I live in the city. I mix with all types of people on the subway.
You don't talk to them?
I talk to them.
Working class people?
Yes, I talked to Stan this morning.
Our doorman?
I'm not going to be bullied by my own daughter about the diversity of my associations. You're saying talking to other people who are educated, who are cosmopolitan, who read, that makes me an elitist, Amina? Fine, I'll cop to it. I am an elitist. I think there's a difference between liberal and conservative, atheist and fundamentalist, good and evil. And I'm not going to sit here and pretend I think all points of view are equal, because I don't. That's not balance, it's stupidity.
You think I'm bullying you?
I think you've grown up taking your freedom for granted. So now, fundamentalism feels to you like one idea among many, instead of what it actually is, the end of ideas.
And you think scoffing at someone else's beliefs makes you the tolerant and enlightened one?
I think it depends. If they respond to that scoffing with fatwas or deadly rights,
when someone desecrates their beliefs,
then I think desecration itself becomes a form of free speech.
So you stand with the book burners.
I'm against the mob in all its forms. I mean, come on, you can't get along with people who would cut out your tongue for insulting their prophet, Amina, who would stone to death their pregnant daughters, or behead a man for following one crazy sheepherder instead of... Am I wrong?
Yes, in fact.
Those things aren't happening.
Many things are happening, mostly good things. And Sam is nothing like that.
Give him time. You live a few more years, Amina, you'll see that people turn into their parents, all of them.
So you're like your father then?
I left. Growing up in a different country, a different context, it...
Sam is in a different context.
No, he isn't.
He's the first in his family to go to college.
A few hours from home. It's still within the gravitational pull. I was separated by oceans. What happens when he moves back to White Plains?
You haven't even met them.
Takes over the family business, selling microwave ovens or steak knives or whatever. When he grows a beard, spends his days at the warehouse with his dad, his evenings with the men of the neighborhood at prayer.
Why can't you just get to know him? You'd actually
like him. I know these people, Amina.
These people? Our people?
They are not our people. We have no people.
Well, maybe we should. Maybe we need a people.
Hey. All right. Food is almost ready. Should we eat soon? I think so.
Fine.
Yeah.
Where's Aisa?
She went back to bed.
Oh, God, it's almost dinner time.
I'll go get her.
Tell her to put clothes on if she wants to come to my table.
Sorry, I didn't mean to start.
You two are so alike. Your friend Sam, he knows his way around a kitchen.
Yeah, I know. His dad can cook, too. Did Pa help out at all?
No, really, but he tried.
Did he say anything awful?
Nothing worse than usual. He was actually surprisingly presentable when you were out of the room.
Good to know. He saves it just for me.
Hey, he's trying, Mina. You know? Give him time. Believe me, he's doing the best he can.
And that was Heather Raffo there at the end playing Naja. I should mention, Amina... by this time at college has been exploring her own faith and discovering Islam and becoming interested herself, which makes the conflict between her and her dad more pointed and starker. And Zayd, I wanted to ask you about that conflict and what was important to you about the articulation of those two like diametrically opposed viewpoints or views of the religion while you're writing the play.
Yeah, well, I guess a couple things jump to mind. One is the generational thing. I started to get interested in the fact that I feel like I've seen the story lots of times about the kind of conservative father or the conservative parents trying to kind of keep their kid from, from opening up, from being more liberal, from assimilating. That's an immigrant story I've seen. It's also, you know, it's Fiddler on the Roof or whatever, which is referenced in the play. But... I thought, you know, I've actually seen more often in the last few years this story of a younger person discovering or kind of exploring a faith that the parents have left behind and what that creates for a family. I just think it's an interesting I suppose it's not a new dynamic. I'm sure it's been happening back and forth for centuries, but it strikes me as a very interestingly flipped kind of American dynamic, what's going on now. And then the other thing about this dispute between the two of them, and it's articulated by different people in the play in different ways, but I thought, you know, this is a conversation we hear in the news and in families, just this kind of the most kind of incendiary stereotypes about Muslims being articulated, and then also the kind of sense that people are cherry-picking those examples and that there's so much more going on. So anyway, it's something we've talked a lot about in the rehearsal room, but it's something I was thinking about is what it looks like when two people really go at it about that issue that we're all reading about all the time.
Mm-hmm. And one of the many reasons that we were happy to have Aasif here to respond to the scenes is, for those of you who don't know, Aasif played the lead in Ayad Akhtar's play Disgraced at Lincoln Center. And they're two very different plays, of course, but some similar thematic concerns, I feel like, and I wonder if you could talk about how you grappled with that during the process of Ayad's play.
Well, you know, when in Ayad's play, the character of Amir has really just disassociated from his Muslim identity entirely, similar to the character mm-hmm. In this play, and has a kind of really articulate sort of point of view about why Islam is dangerous. I mean, Ayad put sort of like, you know, the words of kind of what would normally be sort of like a really radical right-wing sort of, you know, Ann Coulter type character mm-hmm. into the body of a Muslim lawyer, you know? And what I thought was interesting in hearing this was also the prejudice of the elitism, yeah. Of the elitist, mm-hmm. you know? And we were seeing this a lot in our culture now, mm-hmm. Where there's this kind of divide in America between sort of the cultural elites versus sort of those who live by faith, and it's kind of interesting, or yeah. not only live by faith.
No, but are in the flyover like states.
Of
who
sort
are,
of like
yeah.
of like the rejection of science and facts and truth and those things, mm-hmm. versus you know what I think is kind of a movement towards like faith or something, you know, or like I believe it, so therefore it must be true, mm-hmm. and that. Is interesting in this, just the idea that you have this father who is so vehemently anti what he sees as religion, or as like even a conservative sort of Muslim perspective, you know, and he himself has escaped from that and now has found his religion in the sort of intellectual, academic right. kind of, you know, where he calls himself an internationalist and his identity becomes one, a global identity, mm-hmm. like I'm not, you know, you can't pin me down to anything. So that is an interesting dynamic of one character who says you can't pin me down to anything and another character who says I absolutely identify with this one very, you know, and the conflict of that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, as someone who, I mean, I'm from a flyover state and have made my new home in New York City, and I think about it a lot, particularly with the environment that we're living in now, the tension between the between liberal tolerance and the limits of liberal tolerance. Mm-hmm. Like, can you be tolerant of the intolerant?
Right.
Particularly when you're finding it in your own family, you know, and with people you love. Mm. And what does that conversation mean? And Zayd, I kind of wondered, I mean, we've talked about this here and there, but once the election happened, I don't know if you guys knew about this, but there was an election that happened. How did your thinking about the play evolve or change or recontextualize based on the moment that we're living in when suddenly we're, you know, well, yeah. we know where we are?
Yeah, well, I guess for starters, I mean, you know, it obviously changes a lot of what stands out in the play. I mean, to Aasif's point about, like, in Disgrace, the kind of the voice of Ann Coulter, like I didn't write with that in mind, but suddenly you're hear, I hear anyway, echoes of of Sean Spicer or whatever when some of these characters talk, and I think it changes the way we've talked about this in rehearsing it, it changes the way characters would respond to some of these lines, to live in this moment. The play is set in the present, but it was written in a present, you know, a year and a half ago, so it's like, how would characters hear these lines now? It's kind of an interesting thing. I guess for me, the big question that the play tried to wrestle with is maybe more important now, which is like, what does it mean to be an American, like you said? What does it mean to be a Muslim American? And like, can people who have put their identities in a box and said like, that's not me, I'm everything, I'm American, and I can be anything because American identity is so malleable, what happens when somebody says, no, you are that thing, or they're not able to escape that identity? I mean, it's interesting, the thing about the intolerance of liberal elites, like I always imagined this as a family. You know, I grew up with academics and liberal people, and I always imagined this was a family where, like, anybody their daughter brought home would be okay, except for this guy, you know? I certainly know lots of families like this. I know families who are as liberal as they could be, and yet their kid comes out, and it's like, well, I don't want her to be, I don't want her to experience prejudice, so I don't approve of this match. Which has its own weird contradiction.
It's a very liberal way of shutting down your kids. Yeah. I've been thinking a lot about I've been following the early, I don't know, was it 10 years ago when Reza Aslan and Sam Harris first started their debates, and I've been very interested in that conversation, and you know, we've brought it a little bit into the rehearsal room, particularly with the recent Sam Harris Majid Nawaz book, and I wondered, Aasif, if you've engaged in those debates, like, have you tweeted about those things? And if so, what have your tweets been? What is it as a public figure, you know, and as a Muslim American public figure?
Have I tweeted about
weighing in on that sort of the Sam Harris view of Islam versus the Reza Aslan view?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's interesting because I am also somebody who was raised in a Muslim family, so I do have my own my own DNA around what I feel about Islam and what my relationship to it. So you know, when I hear Sam Harris or someone like him talking about the religion that I grew up in, even though I'm not a practitioner that much, there's an immediate kind of response. You know, like I'm sure that we all experience this in some way, you know, where it's like, I can make fun of my family, but you can't,
right, yeah.
You know? Or I know my family can be crazy sometimes, but don't you, you know? So it's that kind of reaction. So I don't feel like I'm always able to engage in those debates in a way that I sort of belie myself. You know what I mean? I kind of get into it with a sense of like I'm bringing my own baggage,
right,
to that, which I'm very very conscious of and trying. And it's something we discussed when we were doing Disgraced as well. You know, Disgraced. Was such a provocative play that you know I was really scared to do it when I first read it, and I was like, I can't say this stuff,
right.
You know, I can't say these words. I don't know how to. There was you know that programming and the thing inside of me that was sort of like, how do I, you know, and I had to sort of find a way through my conversations with the playwright. in terms of like, as an artist, just to try to like put out something that was, you know, not necessarily gonna make people feel comfortable, or even, you know, there is an agenda right now, not an agenda. There is an inherent sort of like thing of like, oh, we shouldn't. Because there's so much negativity portrayed around Islam, and there's so much sort of in the news and in so much of what we see about Muslims and Islam, it's that somehow it is dangerous for Muslims or people who are more familiar with the faith to also criticize or speak in some way that is critical of the religion or of the faith in some way, and when Ayad started doing that as his own truth, it makes people very uncomfortable, and people feel like, oh, you're doing us a disservice, when actually he's saying something that is true for him and actually has more nuance, but it doesn't get seen because all people see is like, oh, there's something going on here that makes me uncomfortable, and doesn't represent the narrative that I want to put out into the world, and that gets challenged.
And can easily be co-opted by right-wing pundits, and that's true with Nawaz. I mean, he has his own things that he's advocating for, but I read some interview with him where he talks about, you know, these liberal journalists who I really admire and have always read are attacking me, and Fox News keeps calling to ask me to come on the show.
Exactly,
you know?
Yes. Yeah.
And he's like, "What? I it's hard to criticize and hard to say, it's hard to call things out without being co-opted.
Without being
somehow.
Co-opted by another agenda,
right.
You know?
Right. Mm-hmm. An agenda that's not necessarily in line with your own agenda. Mm-hmm. Did you feel like it was a constant, did you get through that in Disgraced, or was that a constant tension through the performing of the play?
I think that in the play, that tension was kind of what happened in the, we would end up having these talks with the audience, and I still go, I was at Northwestern just last couple of weeks ago, and they had done Disgrace there, and there were Muslim people coming up to me and being like, can you talk to us about that play, please? Because I'm really disturbed by what I saw, you know? And then I have to sort of be like, well, this is what I've, experienced. And it's like, and then I'm like doing that sort of song and dance. But I think that is, it's an interesting line, and it's something that I think, can happen with this play as well, that sort of, you have the character that Ali played, who is saying things about this Muslim family that I think might make other Muslims uncomfortable, and especially because because it's easy to write it off if it's like, oh, that's some white Fox News sort of watching, but when the criticism or the observation, the maybe an unflattering observation, is coming from within the culture itself, mm-hmm. and then you're going to get a lot of shit for not being Muslim and saying it.
Yeah.
So, get ready for that.
I'm just trying to be ready. Yeah.
Do you want to speak to that, Zayd? I mean, that's what?
Not really, but No. I mean, I can speak to it a little bit. I a lot of my plays are about people who I am not, and or at least many of the characters are, and I think any artist, any writer is always trying to kind of find his or her way out of the kind of box of our own perspective. So part of it is just that, just the urge to tell a story that I thought I could find my way into. I also would say, I mean, I've talked to Ayad about this exact issue, and I think in a way I tried at least to come to this play from a different, I mean, he's able to write from within that faith and within that culture and say, these are the things I struggle with in it. And this play, I don't think, is a critique of Islam or of the kind of the cultural things that come down through it in the way that play is. It's more, as we've talked about, more tries to explore what liberals are thinking, what liberal tolerance looks like. And so the family that I feel like the play is about is not exactly a Muslim family. They are Muslim Americans, I suppose, or they come from a Muslim background, but I thought the story that I could tell, the thing that I could really find my way into, was the story of these kind of cosmopolitan New Yorkers thinking that they could handle anything and then realizing they couldn't handle everything. So that's the one thing I would say. And then the other thing is I would say the artists I really respect and respond to, we've been talking about Tony Kushner, who Aasif and Ali did Homebody Kabul several years ago, or even Oscar Farhadi. Did you guys see his kind of virtual speech last night at the Oscars? This is the great Iranian filmmaker who won for best foreign film last night, and what didn't come because of the Muslim ban refused to come, and had somebody read a statement, and the statement basically said, like, our goal as artists should be to show the humanity in people who others are not seeing that humanity. So for me, this play was always about that project of, like, I don't know, even 2 years ago, let alone now, this was a population that was being demonized and felt vulnerable, and I wanted to do some tiny part of, like, saying, look, these are just people like you, and, you know, you can see them on stage, and these amazing actors who, you know, often play complicated characters, but in our larger culture, the characters we see are not those characters too often. So some small gesture towards that.
Cool. I'm going to set up the next scene. It's also in the Almedin house, and it's between the two sisters of Raif and Naja, Amina, who you met before, and Aissa. It's actually a little bit earlier in the play than the scene that we saw first. And Aissa has been trained as a dancer, but is now bartending in Brooklyn and living back at the family home. And Aissa has just been introduced to Sam. She hasn't been exactly on her best behavior. And Amina and Aissa find themselves alone in the living room. This is the conversation they have. So we'll bring up Frances Benamou playing Aissa, and Tala will come back to play Amina.
Well, he is cute at least.
Ice, can't you just please?
What? Forget it. It doesn't matter.
No, what? Can I please just? That sounded good. I was listening.
Try. Behave.
I would fail.
Okay, I realize you and Pa don't like the idea, but Jesus, do you have to act like such a cunt about it?
Oh, I am liking this more and more. Okay, let me see. I will try not to act like a cunt. But how does a cunt act? It's like a riddle.
Okay, You made your point. I'm sorry.
Why? No, I like it. You've been bottling up that dirty mouth for months, and I'll bet you're just dying to let it out.
See, you're focusing on the one word because you think it gives you some kind of moral upper hand instead of paying attention to what you know I was actually trying to say.
Which is?
You think you're scandalizing Sam or me, but you're not. You're just making yourself look vulgar and ill-bred.
I am vulgar and ill-bred.
You're vulgar. I don't know if you can blame it on the breeding.
Oh, you still got those teeth, huh? Those sharp little Amina teeth? He's gonna have to file those down or muzzle you. Put you in the basement with the women and the other pets.
Why do you have to make such a scene?
Am I the one making
a
scene?
I am not making a scene.
It's like you never went through adolescence when you were supposed to, Mean. You're such a daddy's girl. So now you have to start acting out.
I'm not
at 21.
Acting out.
Get a tattoo. Pierce your nipple. Smoke some crack or something. Please. It'd be so much better than whatever.
This is not a rebellion.
Of all
it's
the
not
guys
a
you could have picked. You know this is Pa's worst nightmare.
I didn't pick him, okay? It happened.
Oh, you couldn't control yourself.
I didn't want to control myself. I'm in love with him.
And I'm happy for you.
Huh.
I am, Mina, but you can live your own life without punishing him, can't you? Pa doesn't deserve this. I don't bring people I'm sleeping with home to meet my parents.
Yeah, you don't bring anyone
exactly.
home.
Why make them suffer?
Maybe because you want them to know who you are? What's important to you? You okay. want to be able to understand
Talk
each other.
Talk about
and
books or politics. They're your parents. Your relationship doesn't have to include the details of your sex life.
This isn't my sex life, Aissa. It's my life.
You're no sex life.
Oh, you know.
What? Why? Wait. Are you having sex with him? Oh, my God!
None of your business.
So, no.
We were. We decided to take a break for a while. I've decided, actually. I mean, it's not like I'm a virgin.
No. So. Oh, I know. I shared a wall with you in high school, remember? It was humiliating. I was completely celibate back then, and my little sister had a different
boys
boyfriend.
Boys always liked you.
Yeah, I didn't want boys.
You should bring someone home. Seriously, they'd be thrilled, you know, after this. Give them a chance to show how accepting they are.
No, thank you.
So, what'd you find anyway in Mom's bathroom when you were snooping?
Her diaphragm.
No, you didn't.
Yes, I did.
Oh my God, they're almost 50.
I know.
Who still uses a diaphragm?
Old people. I've been trying to get Pa to take better care of himself, so we've been jogging.
Jogging, Pa?
I know. It's cool, though. He gets his Bill Clinton jog on with the shorts and the black socks.
Can Matt picture that?
No, I know, I know. But it gets him out of the house, at least.
Yeah. What about you?
What about me? What?
I don't know. You getting out of the house, too?
How do you mean?
I mean, you have any plans, Ice?
What, you mean like for the weekend?
Or the future?
I plan to spend time with my little sister while I still can.
One of the many things that I love about the play is, and it speaks to what you were, I think, saying earlier, Zayd, is that, I mean, it deals with a lot of political issues and sensitive cultural topics and religious topics, but it's very unpolemical. You know, it's a family story or a two-family story, and that's the drive of the play, and I think that scene is a good embodiment of that, the two sisters kind of having it out and loving each other so much. It's such a sisterly argument and coming together. And I guess I'm just curious, Zayd, if you want to talk about the role that gender and sexuality played while you were writing the play, and what was important to you about that, and also how that translates to a broader context, whether religious or cultural.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I think some of it just it's clear in the scene, like the gender, sexuality are such a big part of how many religions think of, you know. Well, let me back up. Religions that are in their most conservative form tend to kind of try to control female sexuality, and obviously that's a big part of the discourse around Islam in America. Like, the people who worry about it the most, the people who defend about it most, are kind of constantly clashing around that question of, I mean, I talked before about the burqa ban in France. What's that about? And it seems to me both sides policing women's bodies in a certain way, and so I thought it'd be interesting to have these two women talk about kind of what their different takes on it, their different understandings of their parents, how when they come home they portray themselves, present themselves, but mainly like two sisters talking about the new guy and about where they are with their own kind of understanding of their femininity or whatever. I mean, in some ways, it's a coming-of-age story, but both for this generation and for the other generation. And so I was interested in giving everybody a chance to talk about like what that means for their love lives, their sex lives, their family lives.
It's in the coming-of-age story. I mean, Amina's coming-of-age is so interesting to me because she's struggling with how to fit in this in her new religious persona. Right? She's struggling to figure out where she fits in with in her own family. In her new in-law family, and also sort of like at the world at large, and it when I'm fascinated by Amina, and when I think about her, I tend to think about the portrayal of Muslims, particularly young American Muslims, in popular culture, in plays, movies, etc. We talked a little bit in rehearsal about the Aziz Ansari Saturday Night Live monologue. If anyone saw that, it was the day after Trump's inauguration. And, you know, he talked about every time you see a Muslim praying on television, like the creepy homeland music is playing underneath it. And that terrifies the everyday American, you know. And he suggested that maybe if you played the Benny Hill music underneath a Muslim praying, then it would be like, you know, what a whimsical, like, religion Islam is. I'm interested, Aasif, in what you've seen both as a artist and as a art maker, but also as like a cultural consumer, as an audience member, like in your career, how have you seen the portrayal of Muslims changing and evolving,
yeah,
or not changing and evolving?
Well, I just want to say that as somebody who grew up in a Muslim home, whenever my mother did pray, we did play Benny Hill music. So I don't know why that's funny. But yeah, I mean, I think, you know, I think like I think the depiction of Muslims on television has, you know, right after 9/11, I remember going auditioning for some made-for-television movie about Islam, and it was literally like, the title sequence was literally just people praying namaz, and then just in the background, just like buildings collapsing and the trade towers burning. And it was like, this was the title sequence of the movie, you know? And and it wasn't
part?
Even
did
and it
landed?
Wasn't even about Muslims. The movie wasn't it. No, so that became sort of, you know, going back to Aziz's thing, like that sort of became the way Islam has been portrayed, and it's a great it's been a great marketing tool for for politicians and for media and stuff to sort of portray Islam in that way. It creates gets a lot of eyeballs when you sort of, you know, show that aspect of it. Whereas the Islam that, you know, I wanted to always portray when I made my movie Today Special, available on Netflix, I wanted to show a father and a son praying. And this movie came out in 2010, so it was a little bit later, but we were still seeing a lot of these sort of images of Muslims, and whenever anything was said in Arabic, it was that, you know, dun, 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 you know, like, and I wanted to show just this father and son praying together, and I put no music under it, and nothing, it was just like a minute and a half of just these two people praying. And it was very sort of benign and sort of spiritual, but kind of in a complete, whatever you wanted to, you know. And I thought that's, because that's what I saw in my home growing up. Like, you know, again, going back to that, when my grandmother prayed, there was no music playing. It was just her, you know. And so has that changed? I think there's more voices, I think, out there now who are, speaking to that. I think now with this election especially, I think you see, I mean, look, Trump has been the best thing for Muslims, because apparently now everybody is a Muslim. You see all these like white people, you know, like walking around with signs that say I am Muslim, and people like me are like, well, I didn't even want to say that I was, but now I've been trying to put it on, what? Not Muslim, not me, you know. I think that you certainly have that voice now, you know, that since this election, just especially.
I'm curious, like pre 9/11, what were the stories that you were finding?
Oh, it wasn't right. Like, the, you know, I don't think that Americans knew there were Muslims pre 9/11. I think they were just like, well, it's those. I think Americans thought Muslim was a cloth, you know?
Fine Muslim fabric.
Think about it. It'll get there. It'll get to the back. and so, you know, I think they woke up one day when that happened and was like, "What? Who are these people? And what is this Quran,
right,
you know, that
right,
they read?" And there you go. But like, I think so I think it was basically, you know, Arabs were just these Bedouins who kind of rode camels and, you know,
right,
and had a lot of oil, and that was, and we needed that,
right,
so, you know,
right. I'm gonna introduce the final scene, which takes place in Act Two. We're now at the Osmond household in White Plains. The Osmond house is expensively and expansively decorated with kind of a modern suburban sheen to it. The Osmonds are hosting the Almedin family for a dinner where they get to meet each other for the first time, which of course is high stakes for everybody involved, most especially Amina and Sam. I'm gonna bring up Ramzi Faragala and Lana Joffrey playing Peter and Carmen. And then you'll see a lot of familiar faces, including a new person playing Sam, Bob Taffy.
Ah, the flowers look nice.
I can't take any credit. Donya picked it up and put it all together.
Who said I gave you any credit? I knew it was Donya just by the colors. If it had been you, it would have been orchids, all white. Donya's the cheerful one.
They're late.
Only a few minutes.
7 minutes.
Carmen, it's rude to show up exactly on the hour. They're being polite. Don't start to
make
a case.
Maybe they won't come at all.
Yes, see? Fashionably on time. Perfect.
Maybe if we don't answer, they'll give up and go away.
It's going to be fine. Hello! Welcome! Come in, come in. I'm Peter. Hello? Yes. You found it? Oh, thank you. Thank you. Look, Carmen, they brought dessert.
Oh, how nice. Thank you.
It's just store-bought from the grocer down the street.
We know it. We love that place, right? We shop there all the time.
Yes, Sam brought me something from there when he stayed with us.
That's very kind.
And thank you, too, for hosting him a few months ago in the city.
It was our pleasure.
My wife, Carmen, Mrs. Almedin.
Naja. Hello.
And Professor Almedin.
I'm not a professor.
No? Sam told me he is reading some of your books in school.
But I don't actually teach classes.
Oh, well, it counts. It counts. No, Professor?
Okay.
Okay. Come in.
Welcome.
Please.
And Emina, so good to see you.
You too. Is everything all right?
Yes.
Is Sam here?
Out on the patio setting up a picnic.
Oh, do you mind?
Not at all. I know you have missed each other with all the texting. Make yourself at home. Sit by the pool. The grown-ups will be able to take care of ourselves for a little while. What can I offer you? Iced tea, coffee?
Now, water would be nice.
Wonderful.
Is the coffee?
Turkish. From our favorite grocer down the street, the same one.
Okay, sure.
We should have invited him too, huh? If he's such a big part of the proceedings. Carmen, coffee for the professor, water for Mrs. Almedin.
You have a beautiful home.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. It's, we have been very fortunate.
Peter, could you give me a hand?
Excuse me?
God, this is like a nightmare.
Stop it!
Really, I feel like I've come to his tent to haggle over a bridal price. And now I'm supposed to offer him so many goats, like... What? Is that funny?
Yeah, the idea of you with the goats.
Look at this place. Where are we?
It's not so bad.
No, it's great. Look, they've hired Vito Corleone's decorator.
Come on. I think it's nice.
Like hell you do. Don't insult your own taste by pretending you think this is nice.
Come on, they're nice and normal compared to what we expected. It could be so much worse.
Yes, says the lost soul upon entering the first circle of the inferno.
I'm so sorry. The stove was acting up. I think she's nervous. Just between the three of us, she has been worried all week about meeting you, getting everything exactly
Why?
Right.
She shouldn't be.
Well, it's a privilege to have such distinguished visitors in our home. An author and a dancer. Ah, yes. You do us an honor. I'm sorry. What were we saying?
Your home. I was admiring.
Yes. I wasn't fishing for compliments, but thank you again.
How long have you lived here?
This place, about a year. A little more than a year.
It looks very new.
Yes, well, we're still getting settled.
It doesn't feel like home yet, honestly. Mm-hmm.
Carmen didn't want to leave the building where we raised our children. Of course, the empty nest. But now, our daughters are married, our son away at college. And I wanted a pool.
Where were you living before?
Queens.
Ah.
Can I take your things?
It's so much better here. You know, peace, solitude.
Yes, that's one thing we don't get much of in the city.
We prefer being around other people.
And you have another daughter, yes?
Aisa, yes.
Is she in school as well?
No, she's our eldest. She's already graduated.
Congratulations.
Thank you. She still lives at home.
She's a dancer.
Ah, like her mother.
Well.
I hear you were quite renowned in your youth.
No, not really.
Well, she said you danced at Lincoln Center.
Just once a long, long time ago.
Well, it's incredible. Carmen, isn't that?
Yes.
But why are we being so formal? We're about to be family, huh? Professor, the Nets game is on. Are you a basketball fan?
No, not really. Baseball, mostly.
Ah, the thinking man's game. The national pastime.
Yes.
Have they told you
Yankees
anything about
Mets.
The wedding. We can't get a
good
thing
man.
Out
I
of
don't
Boston.
Trust Yankee
no,
fans.
We're in the dark too.
They have
I
life
know
is too
they
easy
want
for them,
to
don't you think?
Small,
losing
but
builds character.
I think family should always
Jets
be
and
invited.
Nets, since I moved to
his
the
aunt
city,
is almost broken hearted.
Character.
Well, we don't even know
we
when or where it's
game
happening.
Sometime together.
I don't like it.
From
the rush.
Sure, maybe.
Why can't they wait until they graduate?
I agree.
Hey, Masab! Can you come and say hello to the professor and Mrs. Almedin? I'm sorry, he is forgetful of his manners, like most young men of his age.
It's all right.
But you know, he is a great admirer of yours.
He tells us Amina is an excellent student.
Yes, unlike her sister.
It's good. It is very good to be so diligent with her studies.
Mm. It's not diligence, I don't think.
No?
School was always easy for her.
Ah, of course. Natural ability. You're right. I had no gift as a student, so diligence is what I understand. Ah, here they are, the happy couple.
We were just catching up.
Of course. Plenty to talk about when it's been 2 full hours since you spoke on the phone and 3 minutes since the texting.
Hello, sir, Mrs. Almedin. Thank you for coming.
Naja, would you like a tour?
Oh, yes, that would be lovely.
Please.
Thank you.
Tell me, Bassam, about the professor's books. I have been wanting to hear more. I am ashamed to say that I haven't read them yet.
Well, they're not required reading.
They're assigned in universities all over the country.
I wish I had more time to read for pleasure. I have heard of them, of course, your books, and not just from Bassam. Apparently, they're quite renowned.
Well, don't believe everything you hear.
It's wonderful. Most of us who come to this country, we are lucky if we open a dry cleaner, a fruit stand, let alone win awards, recognitions as an American man of letters. Extraordinary.
You seem to have done pretty well for yourself.
Ah, well, people always need ovens, freezers, books. Only if they are inspired. I promise I will read one before the wedding.
You don't have to do that.
No, I would like to. What are they about, your books, in simple terms?
Oh, they're mostly stories from my experience. Immigration, exile, being a stranger in a strange land, and that sort of.
Ah, I would like them. That is my story, too. And they are set here in the U.S.?
Yes, mostly.
And the genre, forgive my ignorance, are they mysteries, romances?
Satire, mostly, kind of.
Ah, fascinating. Bassam, if you sat me down and you said, write a satire, what would I do?
I don't know.
I would beat my face against the typewriter until my head broke like an egg. That is what I would
do.
Well,
I don't know if I would know how to run a business either, so.
You would learn. There isn't much to it. Numbers and yelling
I
at people
doubt
mostly.
That.
No. I never went to college. That's why my shameful ignorance when it comes to literature. But I respect learning. Did Bassam tell you how I grew up?
No.
Dad?
Both of my parents were illiterate, humble people. But my mother died when I was young, and so my father brought us to live with my aunt. She was very devout, and so she had the pages. And I taught myself to read in order to escape the life of a...
He doesn't want to hear all this.
I apologize. One feels the need to justify one's ignorance in front of...
No, it's interesting. My parents were well-read in their way, something like your aunt. But I had to teach myself English in order to escape their kind of learning, to earn a scholarship to come here. So it's similar in a way, isn't it?
Yes, we both escaped through books. It's a funny coincidence.
It's beautiful, Raif. You should really see the rest of this place. We haven't even been upstairs yet. It goes on and on.
Sure,
No, the professor doesn't want to see the furniture. It's just a house. He has seen plenty of houses. And we have been starving our guests.
No, not at all.
No, we should go outside, huh? It is brisk, but I set up the heaters. We can talk in the fresh air. And I hope you're hungry. Carmen has assembled a feast fit for a wedding. Although, I suppose in this case, appropriate, no?
So I'm endlessly fascinated by this scene because in Act Two is where we meet the Osman family. Except for Sam, we haven't met any of them for the whole first act of the play. So all we have to go by is how they're discussed, and particularly, you know, how Raif discusses them. And so the Almedin family's assumptions are kind of, they clash in this scene with the reality of who the Osman family actually is. I want to ask you, Zayd, if you have any sort of hopes or intentions or curiosities about how the audience is going to react to the scene in terms of what their assumptions might be, or if you were thinking about that at all while you were making it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we spend most of the first act in an apartment in Greenwich Village of these very westernized academics, and as Kip says, they spend a lot of time talking about these people in White Plains in somewhat disparaging terms sometimes, or at least fearful terms. And I guess for me, it was partly about starting the audience, which I figured would be a New York audience or a Chicago audience or an LA audience, to start them in a place they kind of knew, or at least sort of knew, or felt like they knew. And then to bring them by Act Two into a place that they had been told was going to be very strange and very unfamiliar and very uncomfortable. And then it kind of isn't, but it also sort of is. I mean, it turns out that the prejudice that Raif has and that some of the other characters have is woven through other kinds of prejudice, that there's a class thing and there's a flyover state thing and there's a non-cosmopolitan, non-city thing, and that it's all so that even as they're kind of, they see this place and it's not whatever they thought it was going to be, a tent in the desert or something. It's not that, but it's still like not what he wants for his daughter. It's something else. It's suburban and it's bourgeois and it's other things. So I don't know. It's about those expectations about what we see in this family. But it turns out they're just people like everybody. They're different from these people, and they still have their own kind of cultural issues. But I guess I hope that the audience will have to spend some time thinking about, like, is this what I thought it would be, and why did I think that other thing, and what is it really? Something like that.
Cool. And a common thread that I see in both of you guys' work seems to me to be empathy for an otherized community. Aasif, your work on the on Halal and the Family, though I missed the original title. I don't know if there, it was called, would you want to talk about that really quick?
The original title,
yeah,
of Halal and the Family?
Yeah.
Well, it was originally, we created it as a parody of the Cosby Show. So it was originally called the Cosby Show. Like Q-U apostrophe O-S-B-Y.
So was there a copyright situation with the Cosby Show, or was that like...
No, it was just that Mr. Bill Cosby got himself in a little bit of hot water.
Oh, yeah, of course.
As it were, like, I think 72 times or something. I don't know. And we just really felt like the name might become a liability.
Right.
Or might distract from what we were trying to do, which was... which had... nothing to do with being a sexual predator. So we changed it to, I think, a better title. But what was your question about that?
I wanted you to talk a little bit about that, but also in Sakina's Restaurant, your solo play, and Zayd and plays like this, of course, and Outside People and Long Way Go Down. Mm. I wanted to ask you guys what's important to you in your work, how conscious it is to be reaching for a understanding and empathy and investigation of the normality of people who are otherized.
I mean, I definitely felt like that was something that when I did Sakina's Restaurant, which was a one-man show I did many years ago, one of the things I was consciously trying to do was portray three-dimensional characters of people that for most sort of American audiences they would have only seen in a kind of, you know, very two-dimensional sort of stereotypical way. And so you, similar to what you've done in this play, I think, really well, which is sort of present that stereotype and then challenge it. And, mm-hmm. you know, what happens, what I think is so great about this is that you meet this family and they're actually really nice. Mm-hmm. Like the father is actually maybe this, he's sort of very fun-loving and seems really, gracious and those prejudices that Raif walks in with, are those prejudices are not what he thought they were, like you said, but now they're just dealing with their differences. Mm-hmm. So there's, mm-hmm. you know, as opposed to...
They're human differences.
Right, they're like human differences. And yet they have similar, they clearly have similar backgrounds and, right. and similar stories. So that is, you know, one of the things that I think art can do is sort of bridge that kind of divide or, you know, that sort of... There was a really interesting moment that happened when Ali, who played Raif, he and I did Homebody Cobble, the Kushner play at the Steppenwolf many years ago, and I remember there was a talk back with the audience, and in the play I played a Taliban mullah, and Tony Kushner had sort of given this Taliban mullah a great deal, a whole monologue about sort of the history of Afghanistan and how we ended up here, and you know, as only Kushner can. And I remember a woman in the audience raising her hand, and she said, I felt empathy for your character. And all of us on stage, you know, actors and sort of artists were all kind of like, great, it's great. And she was like, no, that's not good. And we were kind of like, what do you mean? And she was like, I don't want to feel empathy
right.
for that character. And she was like, so she had been completely taken out of her comfort zone. She literally was like, I don't like being where I am, which is that I am now empathizing with something that I vehemently disagree with or have a prejudice about in some way that or I think I know. So I think that's really just the work of the artist at his or her best, you know.
It's actually, I was thinking about something Kushner writes in one of his essays. We've been talking about this, and he talks about empathy, and he basically says something to the effect of, like, the role of an artist is to, you know, to imagine the other in as graceful bounds as possible. And he says it's always a failure. He says failure mm-hmm. is axiomatic to the project of art. One can never become the other. One can never fully synthesize. But what's fun about being an audience member or about observing art is that you're watching somebody try to do something that's impossible, and that's kind of what it is to be human, and that it makes those connections, you know, a little bit tighter. It also makes me think, I don't know if any of you guys saw this crazy article, I think it was today in the Times, about this small town in southern Illinois where this undocumented owner of the local Mexican restaurant just got deported, and they were all like, well, we voted for Trump, but we didn't mean Carlos should be deported. He's a great guy. We meant those other,
right.
the bad Mexicans should go. And I do think there's something just to the idea of, I mean, it's art certainly, but just like proximity. And part of what I do think is valuable about cosmopolitanism is that everybody's close enough to like see each other go to the grocery store or whatever. And without that, you don't make that connection. You don't see how similar we all are.
Well, I think that's actually like a positive aspect of the fact that you are writing about a community that is not necessarily the community that, you know, a difference of me writing about that community where I bring my own baggage. I may bring a certain baggage or nuance or something that I have, but what you have is the voice of somebody looking at it from the outside and observing it in a way that where you bring your own stuff from your own baggage from where you come from, you know, which is allows a synthesis to happen that I think enriches the characters in a different way.
Do you feel, Zayd, like that's a conscious thing for you, not just in this play, but in plays in general, that idea of the Tony Kushner idea of...
I think it's become conscious. I think it's why I started writing. More than, it wasn't conscious, like, I want to do this. It was more like, I'm interested in figuring people out. Why do other people act that way, and I act this way, and they're weird, and I don't get it. And even as a teenager, thinking about those things was always important to me. And honestly, it was really reading Tony Kushner and other people like him, and seeing those things and thinking, like, those were the moments when I felt most human, when I could see somebody totally different from me and feel like I get it. I mean, Homebody Cobble, I saw right after 9/11, and what a crazy thing that he could have written that play, you know, a year before that, and not only seen what was happening in the world and been able to look as far away as Afghanistan from New York City and see the humanity there and the conflicts that were about to like fall upon all of us here. And I mean, there are monologues, I guess your monologues in that play that seem to like say, look at what you're doing to us here and we will visit this upon you. Mm-hmm. And so I think there's something very powerful about an artist being able to try to imagine people that different and you can see things about the world that you couldn't see without it.
And also, as a famous dude, do you feel a pressure in your work to influence the narrative or help steer the narrative in terms of, I'm going back a little bit to my earlier question about portrayal of, mm-hmm. of Muslims in popular culture. Do you feel an onus on you somehow?
Yes, there is that. You know, I mean, I think that is something that Ayad and I actually discussed this a lot. That idea of like how to stay true to the story that you want to tell, and not let that influence of I'll alienate people, or people will not like what I'm trying to say, or they won't understand what I'm trying to say, which is even maybe worse, mm-hmm. you know? And actually just try to be true to that. So yeah, there is, you know, again, it's like sometimes I worry that I'm a fish who doesn't know that he's inside water, you know, like because my own DNA has a certain reactive quality to like writing about my own cultural experience and my own stuff. I can't, and that's why I think there's something positive in you coming from a different place, because I sometimes can't see the inherent limitations of what I'm, you know, so trying to break out of that is actually valuable.
Right.
But it is a struggle, yeah, to you know, one of the things that I love is, you know, Louis C.K. used to do this thing where he would get up on stage and for the first 5 or 6 minutes of his act, he would do like just really crap jokes and on purpose, and the audience would not laugh. And they would just kind of go like, what's happening? This is Louis C.K., like, isn't he supposed to be really funny? And he said that when I did that, the audience, the bar got leveled out. Like it was like suddenly, like they were looking at me like, he's not funny. And what's happened to him, you know? And then I could do my real material, because then they weren't just giving me the applause benefit. They think I deserve because I'm who I am, right? Yeah. So that's brave. That's, you know, that is a challenge to sort of get out there and disappoint your audience.
Maybe we should do the first act really crappily.
Yeah.
And then the second act, we'll play like gangbusters. We'll level out the playing field.
But yeah, so I think about that sometimes.
Yeah. I feel like Halal and the Family is so successful at, I mean, watching it, everyone should watch it.
It's available
website?
Online. It's available on Funny or Die, halalandthefamily.tv, where else? Like everywhere. Everywhere where computers are.
I find it just so like immediately hilarious as a sitcom satire. Do
yes,
you know what I mean?
Yes.
Like that's the trope that you're working in.
Right, right.
And then the other stuff is sneakier. Do you know what I mean? Because
yeah.
I feel like the, at least for me,
yeah.
As a white guy, like watching it, I more respond to the 80s sitcom parody.
Right.
You know, and then the actual material of it I can absorb.
Well, it's interesting because, you know, we did that as a, it was sort of, we wanted to talk about certain issues, you know, and we couched them in the vein of this 80s sitcom parody, and I think we were effective in doing that, and because you sort of, you know, you come for the parody and then you stay for the real, suddenly there's a PSA
right.
in there, you know. But now we're actually doing that, we're actually making Halal and the Family into an animated series. and writing it as an animated show where it's no longer a parody, it actually is just what it is, and sort of addressing the satire of it just as a show,
right,
is a different thing, and suddenly it has a different quality, and trying to say something. Now it's just an animated family that is living in, you know, in Miracle, Florida, or wherever, you know. Right. So it is a different task, but it's just now straight up satire.
Right.
You know, using that trope of a family.
Not satirizing cartoon, like family, cartoon families.
Like, we're not satirizing the form.
Right.
We are literally just using the content, you know. So, yeah.
Cool.